In the last class, we have discussed about the different types of CE amplifier, and we have also calculated the corresponding voltage gain pertaining to each of these amplifiers. Now today, let us first try to recapitulate what we have learned in the last class. So more specifically, we have considered voltage divider biasing circuit, and accordingly, we have calculated the voltage gain, including emitter resistance in one case and without including emitter resistance in the other case. So let us start with the voltage divider biasing circuit. We have two resistances like this, R1 and R2. We have a collector resistance over here, RC. And this emitter terminal is directly connected to ground. Now we have these two resistances over here, R1, R2, we have RC, and the supply is from this particular point. We are taking the output from this one. This is connected base, and through this coupling capacitor, the signal source, small signal source, is being fed. So this is the first circuit diagram what we have discussed, and for that the expression for voltage gain was coming like minus GM times RC. That means there is a phase difference of 180 degree between the input and the output, so that's why this negative sign is appearing over here. And as far as the magnitude is concerned, we find that it is like GM times RC. So the voltage gain is depending on the transistor internal parameter GM. Now on the other hand, we have also considered a similar common emitter amplifier circuit in which the emitter terminal is connected to ground through a resistance RE. So all the aspects of this new circuit being the same, only you have this resistance RE connected to the emitter terminal, and the other parameters are remaining as it is. R1, R2, RC. We have a supply from this particular point, and there is a coupling capacitor through which the signal is being fed. Small signal is being fed, Vs. Now for this second circuit, so if I want to identify this circuit as the first circuit, circuit number one, and this circuit being the second circuit, circuit number two, now we have calculated the voltage gain for this circuit, and the voltage gain was coming like minus RC upon RE. So once again, there is a phase difference of 180 degree between the input and the output. We're taking the output from this particular terminal, V0. But however, this voltage gain is not dependent upon the transistor internal parameter. Rather, it's a function of these two resistances, RC and RE. So if I know these two resistances properly, and if I keep these two resistances fixed, and even if I change the transistor, or even if we substitute the transistor with a different one, then also the voltage gain is remaining a constant. So as a matter of fact, we can say that this first circuit is much more unstable with respect to the second one because of the presence of this parameter GM. So as you know, GM is a strong function of temperature, and if I change the transistor or substitute the transistor by a new one, so there is a possibility that the GM gets modified, and as a matter of fact, the voltage gain will be modified if I change the transistor in this particular circuit diagram. However, for this case, the voltage gain is heavily dependent upon these two resistances only, RC and RE. So if these two resistances are fixed, so then we can expect that the voltage gain is remaining fairly constant. So if I now summarize the discussion, if I compare this first architecture with the second one, we find that for the first common emitter amplifier, we have comparatively higher value of the voltage gain, comparatively higher AV, because this GM times RC is much, much larger as compared to this RC by RE. So higher AV for the first diagram, for the first circuit, and lower AV for the second diagram, second circuit. However, because of the presence of this GM, this first circuit is less stable. So there is a stability issue. And this circuit is more stable because there is a feedback which is being provided by this particular resistance RE. So this RE basically provides a feedback from the output to the input. So we will discuss this feedback issue in much more detail while we will consider some later unit of this particular course. But right now, let us try to identify these two properties of any amplifier. One is the gain property and second one is the stability property. So for any amplifier design, our fundamental objective is to increase the value of the voltage gain. So obviously, for any amplifier, our objective will be to increase the value of voltage gain. That is the requirement from our side, from the circuit designer's perspective. And second one is the enhancement of the stability of the circuit, so more stable. So as a circuit designer, you must expect a higher voltage gain, higher AV with stability. So these are the two essential requirements. Now, if I just compare these two circuit diagrams, circuit 1 and circuit 2, you'll find that this higher AV is accomplished by circuit 1, whereas higher stability is obtained from circuit 2. So can't we have a single design for which this higher AV as well as more stability is ascertained? Now, for this particular purpose, we have to modify the circuit of either 1 or 2 so that we can have a higher voltage gain as well as more stable amplifier circuit. Now let us move to the next slide and let me draw this voltage divider biasing once again with a slight modification so that the requirements will be fulfilled. So as far as the voltage divider architecture is concerned, so there is no such change. We have these two resistances as before, R1 and R2. We have to include this emitter resistance, obviously, because this emitter resistance will enhance the stability. During the discussion on BJT bias, we have already identified the role of this emitter resistance in enhancing the stability of this particular circuit. So here we have Vs. This is the coupling capacitor CC. So this is the resistance R1. This resistance is R2. This resistance is RE. This is, we have over here RC, this one. So this one is RC. This one is RC, and we have the VCC supply from this point. And we are getting the output from this particular terminal. So this is essentially the second diagram, second circuit diagram, for which the voltage gain is less, but it is much more stable. So now to increase the voltage gain, what is basically done? One capacitor is connected in shunt with this emitter resistance RE. And the role of this capacitor is to bypass the small signal current through this path. Now, while connecting this capacitor, you have to identify that the role of the capacitor will be nothing during the DC analysis, because the reactance of any capacitance is given by 1 by j omega c. 1 by j omega c, that is equal to 1 by j twice pi fc. So when we are considering the DC analysis, so for DC analysis, whenever the signal frequency is zero, for DC analysis, F is equal to zero, we only apply this supply VCC, the DC supply, in order to obtain the different DC current and voltage components. So during that time, since the frequency operation equal to zero, so the capacitor over here, this bypass capacitor, will provide an infinite impedance. And since it is connected in shunt path, so obviously no amount of current will flow through this. Similarly, for the coupling capacitor, the corresponding reactance provided by this capacitor is also infinite. So it will isolate the signal source from the rest of the amplifier. So for DC analysis, we can have almost the same equation which we have already derived. Now let me write down the equation. If I apply the KVL, Kirchhoff's voltage law, across this collector terminal loop, we can directly write like this: VCC is equal to IC times RC plus VCE plus IERE. Now we know that this IE is equal to 1 plus beta upon beta times RC, IC. Now, in case when beta is very, very large with respect to 1, normally the value of beta is in the order of 100 to 200. So this 1 plus beta by beta could have been approximated to 1. So in this case, the expression for VCC becomes IC multiplied with RC plus RE, as I'm assuming that IE and IC, they're almost equal, plus VCE. So this is the essential equation for the load line calculation. And we have already discussed how to draw the load line from this particular KVL equation. So that is quite obvious from the DC analysis perspective. Now, what happens during the AC analysis? Now, for the AC analysis, we have to redraw this particular circuit diagram. Now, for AC analysis, as you know, these two resistances, R1 and R2, they will be there. R1 and R2. Now we have this transistor. Now, this particular point, previously it was connected to VCC for during the DC analysis. Now, for the small signal or AC analysis, since it is connected to a ideal DC supply, so the small signal component present over here is zero. So during the AC equivalent circuit, I can directly consider this point to be at AC ground, because since it is kept at a constant DC potential, so the small signal variation at this particular point is zero, and hence we can treat this particular terminal to be at AC ground. Now, what happens over here? We have a shunt path. We have a resistance RE, emitter resistance RE, in shunt with a capacitor, bypass capacitor CE. Now, we have to select the value of CE in such a way that at signal frequency, the value of the resistance RE is higher as compared to, or much, much higher as compared to, the reactance provided by the capacitance. In other words, I can say that at signal frequency, the value of CE is chosen in such a way that at signal frequency, the reactance provided by this particular capacitance is essentially considered to be close to zero. So we have a resistance over here, a non-zero resistance in the order of few hundreds of ohms, or in the order of few kilo ohms, resistance connected over here as RE. And in shunt, we have another path over here for which the corresponding impedance is equal to almost close to zero at the signal frequency. So as a matter of fact, the small signal current will, all the small signal current will pass through this path, and that's why this path is known as a bypass path, and this particular capacitor is known as a bypass capacitor. So during the small signal analysis, what happens? Almost all the current components, small signal current, will flow through this path, and hence, this particular terminal, the potential at this particular terminal is kept constant. Because since the reactance is close to zero, so as a matter of fact, these two points, this point and this ground point, this DC ground and this point, they are essentially connected together. So as a matter of fact, I can consider this emitter terminal is having a constant potential, constant DC potential. Even if there is a small signal present over here. So it will find a simpler path to go to the ground through this particular capacitor CE. So since this particular potential is almost constant, so I can consider that this particular point is at AC ground. So there is no such fluctuation due to the small signal present over here. Whenever there is an input signal riding like this on a DC value, so you expect that the output will look something like that. There is a phase reversal and it's a magnified version. So if it is like 5 millivolt peak to peak, if it is like 5 millivolt peak to peak, so you can expect over here almost say 500 millivolt peak to peak, so almost a gain of 100. At the same time, there is a phase reversal. But however, the corresponding fluctuation at this particular point due to this small signal perturbation is neglected. So this point is considered to be at AC ground. So I can connect this to AC ground. Now, whatever this coupling capacitor, I'm assuming that at signal frequency, the impedance provided by this coupling capacitor is negligibly small. So I can consider it to be short circuited, just like the bypass capacitor. So VS is connected directly to the base terminal. This is VS. Or you can also include some source resistance. In that case, the corresponding coupling loss we need to take into account. Now, had this been the case, so this is the RC value. Had this been the case, now we are in a position to write down the KVL equation from the small signal equivalent circuit. So what is the KVL equation over here? So this is at AC ground, so it should be 0 is equal to ICRC plus VCE. So all these current components and the voltage components, they are the small signal components. So IC is the small signal current and small signal collector current, and VC is the small signal collector to emitter voltage. So ICRC plus VC is equal to 0. So eventually we have got two different equations, one for the DC analysis, this one, VCC is equal to ICRC plus ICRE plus VC. This is coming from the DC analysis, which relates the output current IC with the output voltage VC. And this is the second equation, which relates, once again, the output current IC with the output voltage VC, but these output current and voltage are the small signal current and small signal voltage. Now, given these two equations, we can easily draw the corresponding load lines. Now, the drawing of this DC load line is already discussed in some previous lecture. Let me first mark the corresponding axis. So this is the horizontal axis, which is nothing but the collector to emitter voltage. And this is the collector current. So let me write down the equation. VCC is equal to IC times RC plus RE plus VCE. So this is from the DC analysis, and from the AC analysis, we have ICRC plus VCE is equal to 0. Now, how to draw the DC load line? First of all, to draw a DC load line, you need to identify the two extreme points. So one point is obtained for IC is equal to 0, and you have to calculate what is the value of VC. And the second point is obtained by putting VC is equal to 0. Now, for VC is equal to 0, what is the value of IC? This is nothing but VCC upon RC plus RE. So I have to identify this point on this vertical axis over here. So this point corresponds to VC is equal to 0. And the value is VCC upon RC plus RE. And this point is corresponding to IC is equal to 0 and the value is nothing but VCC. So this is the DC load line, and we can also identify what is the slope of the DC load line. The slope is given by minus 1 upon RC plus RE. If I represent this equation in Y is equal to MX plus C form, then you can see that IC is equal to VCC by RC plus RE minus VCE by RC plus RE. So therefore, this slope of this straight line is given by minus 1 upon RC plus RE. Now, side by side, we can also draw the transistor characteristics, which are drawn for different values of base current. This is for IB2, for example. This is for IB3. This is for IB4. This is for IB5, and so on. Now, for example, so this is, say, drawn with IB1 base current. This is with IB2 base current. So for different base current, we have different characteristics curve. This is for IB5. And suppose the circuit is biased in such a way that the DC value of the base current is nothing but IB4. So in order to obtain the corresponding quiescent collector current and quiescent collector to emitter voltage, I have to identify this point, which is nothing but the intercept between this transistor curve for IB4 base current and the DC load line. So the device property and the circuit property, these two are satisfied over here, and I have to identify the corresponding intercept. So this one is known as the VCEQ, the quiescent collector to emitter voltage. And this one is known as the quiescent collector current, ICQ and VCEQ. So this has been already discussed in some previous module. Now, if I just take a look at the second equation, ICRC plus VC is equal to 0. Now, this equation is drawn for small signal analysis or for AC analysis. So I can clearly identify what is the slope of this particular straight line. This is an equation of straight line because these two are connected, these two variables, IC and VC, they are connected in Y is equal to MX, this particular form. So as a matter of fact, I can already identify what is the slope. The slope of this particular straight line is given by minus 1 upon RC. So I can write IC is equal to minus VC by RC. So the slope is given by minus 1 upon RC. Now, just by knowing the slope, it is not possible for us to draw any straight line. Another thing which we must know is the point through which this straight line is passing. So this particular straight line passes through IC is equal to 0 and VC is equal to 0. So 0, 0 gets satisfied for this particular straight line. Now, what do you mean by IC is equal to 0 and VC is equal to 0? Remember, this IC is nothing but the small signal collector current, and VC is nothing but the small signal collector to emitter voltage. Now, already we know that the total instantaneous collector to emitter voltage, VCE, as far as our notation is concerned, this is given by this VCEQ plus small VC. So we have the small signal component over here, and we have the DC component over here, VCEQ. Now, whenever we write that VCE is equal to 0, small VC is equal to 0, that means the small signal component equal to 0, that means the total instantaneous current is nothing but, the total instantaneous voltage is nothing but this DC voltage, VCEQ. Similarly, for the current, this I capital C is equal to ICQ. So whenever we are here at IC is equal to 0 and VC is equal to 0, it essentially signifies that we are at the TC operating point. That means we are at the quiescent operating point. That means we are over here. As a matter of fact, we can identify that this particular straight line, the second straight line, which is drawn from the AC analysis, must pass through this quiescent operating point, having a higher slope. So the slope is high with respect to the slope of this DC load line. So for the DC load line, the slope is minus 1 upon RC plus RE. And for the AC load line, which we are going to draw over here, is having a slope of minus 1 upon RC. This slope is minus 1 upon RC. So this slope is higher, just like this. So this slope is much more steeper, minus 1 upon RC, which is drawn with this gray color. And this red color straight line is for the DC load line. Now, already we know that this is the DC line. Now, whenever there is an excursion of the base current, so initially, whenever the signal, the small signal was absent, the base current was IB4. Now, suppose there is a corresponding excursion of base current because of the application of the small signal voltage source at the base side. And as a matter of fact, for example, this is the corresponding fluctuation of the base current from IB5 to IB3, just like this. I'm drawn just a single cycle. Now, by virtue of that, there is a corresponding change in the collector current. Whenever the base current reaches at its peak, the positive peak, then the collector current also reaches at their positive peak, because as long as we are operating the transistor in the active or linear region, so then this collector current and base current, they must follow this linear relationship. So whenever this base current is maximum at IB5, then the collector current is also maximum over here. And the corresponding collector to emitter voltage, we can directly obtain from the projection over here. And the collector to emitter voltage will be minimum, will be at the negative peak. Similarly, whenever the base current is minimum at IB3, then the collector current is also minimum, and the corresponding collector to emitter voltage is at the positive peak. So from this analysis also, it is very clear why there is a corresponding phase difference of 180 degree between the output voltage and the input voltage. So it looks something like that. So this is for VCE. So this line is having a slope of minus 1 upon RC, and this line is having a slope of minus 1 upon RC plus RE. So if I just follow this AC load line, we can directly obtain what is the value of the small signal voltage, output voltage, just by projecting across the corresponding AC load line. Now, if I want to draw the small signal equivalent model, already we have drawn this one for this particular circuit. And if I want to calculate the gain parameter, then we have to replace the transistor by means of its corresponding pi model, or you can also use H parameter model, because these two models are essentially the same. So you have Vs over here, so this is CCR, or we can also consider that the capacitor is providing zero reactance or zero impedance at signal frequency, so it can be shorted together. So now to find out the expression for the voltage gain between base to emitter, we have this resistance R pi. Now right now we can also neglect the effect of this output resistance R naught. So simply we have Gm times V pi over here. This is R pi. This is Gm times V pi, the current source. Now these are the two resistances R1 and R2. So they are connected in shunt. One terminal is at the base, the other terminal is at ground. Now since emitter is grounded, in the AC equivalent model, emitter is grounded, emitter is at AC ground. So therefore I can directly connect them together with the emitter itself. So this resistance is nothing but R1 parallel R2. Now we have a signal source connected between base to emitter, since it's a common emitter configuration, and this potential is considered to be V pi. Now over here we have RC. This is grounded. So this is RC. This terminal is a collector terminal. As you know, this is the base terminal. This is the emitter terminal. And we are taking the output across this point. So what will be the output voltage? So in order to obtain the output voltage, so output voltage is nothing but the voltage at the collector terminal with respect to emitter. So now since the direction of the current is this way, that means the current is flowing in this way. So therefore, the voltage is given by minus Gm times V pi times RC. Now from this particular diagram, we can say that this signal source is equal to V pi. That means there is no coupling loss. This entire signal source is being coupled over here at the input of the amplifier. In case you have some resistance over here, some non-zero source resistance RS, then you have to calculate the coupling factor. And in that case, Vs will not be equal to V pi. Rather, V pi will be somewhat less as compared to Vs because of this coupling loss. But for simplicity here, we have just neglected this one. Source resistance, so Vs equal to V pi. In the last discussion, we have also mentioned how to calculate this coupling loss for non-zero source resistance. Now for this, we can write it is to be minus Gm Vs RC. So the expression for the voltage gain AV, which is nothing but V naught upon Vs, is coming to be minus Gm times RC. So the voltage gain is high. If I consider the magnitude, this voltage gain is high. It is like Gm times RC. It is large, but at the same time, during the DC analysis, since the emitter was there, so this circuit, so let me go back. During the DC analysis, we have already seen that since the resistance RE is over here, so this particular resistance will provide a kind of feedback. And as a matter of fact, we find that this particular circuit is much more stable with respect to the corresponding fluctuation. So this particular circuit serves the purpose of having higher voltage gain. At the same time, it is stable with respect to the fluctuation. Now let us try to have another circuit to identify the role of this capacitor, bypass capacitor over here. So sometimes instead of bypassing the entire emitter resistance, what is done is a portion of the emitter resistance is bypassed and the rest of the portion is not bypassed. So we have this circuit as it is, VCC. We have a capacitor, coupling capacitor over here. Signal source, Vs, coupling capacitor, we have resistance R1, R2. We are taking the output from this terminal. Now, instead of bypassing the entire emitter resistance, we have divided the emitter resistance into two different segments. Let it be RE1 and RE2. So the total resistance RE is equal to RE1 plus RE2. For DC-wise, there is no change. However, during the AC analysis, we want that this RE2 is bypassed. So total emitter resistance is not bypassed. Only this RE2 is bypassed during the small signal analysis. So the stability is being provided by these two resistances, RE1 and RE2. And if I draw the small signal model for this particular circuit, we'll find that the voltage gain is given by, so this one is RC, collector resistance. So voltage source is given by minus RC upon RE1, minus RC upon RE1, approximately. The voltage gain is approximately given by minus RC upon RE1. Because RE2, this particular thing, is already bypassed by means of this capacitor, bypass capacitor. So instead of having the RE1 plus RE2 combination, we have only RE1, which is connected to the emitter terminal. And through this RE1, emitter is essentially connected to the AC ground. And if we go back, or if we consider our last day's discussion regarding the calculation of the voltage gain whenever there is a resistance, emitter resistance connected in series with this emitter terminal. So in that case, we can easily find out that this resistance is nothing but RE1 resistance. And as a matter of fact, the voltage gain over here is given by minus RC upon RE1. Once again, if I want to identify the corresponding slope for the DC load line and the AC load line, so here for the DC load line, the slope is given by minus 1 upon RC plus RE1 plus RE2. Because for DC analysis, all of these two resistances, RE1 and RE2, will be there, and RC is obviously there. So for the DC load line, this is the slope, minus 1 upon RC plus RE1 plus RE2. However, for AC load line, the slope would be different. And for AC load line, we don't have the provision for RE2 because RE2 is already bypassed. So the slope is given by minus 1 upon RC plus RE1. So it will be different. And however, the AC load line is having a much steeper slope as compared to the slope of the DC load line. Now with this, let me conclude the discussion on AC load line and DC load line.